judged by the size of the company.
I have clicked OK, so we should now be streaming. And indeed, we are live. Hello, good evening. Hello, everybody. Let me just swap the things about a little bit. You will see up there, that's Matt. Matt's with us. Say hello, Matt. Tis live. Tis now live on the live page. That's all good. It's all working. So we've got Matt in with us. We've got Marco Van Basten is with us. Hello, Marco.
Yes,
we have Mark here. We also have the delightful Sav.
Hi.
The bountiful beautiful. I couldn't get it, man.
No wonder why.
It just wasn't working for us. I still haven't sobered up properly, I don't think. It's been one of those weekends this weekend. But yes, we is live. Apparently, according to Ridian, VIP's own party leader is in the House of Lords viewing gallery.
Is he really?
He is, apparently. Which is very good.
Purple flower.
Hang on.
Oh, no, that's the Commons.
That's the Commons. It's a different thing altogether. Yes. So, what's going to be happening tonight is once these lot in there start talking about e-cigs, we'll move to it. And we'll mute all the mics and the hangouts and stuff like that, and then we'll talk in chat. If anything serious comes up, we'll butt in, and we'll butt in with this shot.
Their local area,
which will
and
look
local
like
needs.
That with Mark. Well,
whether
Marco's
that be through gross cost or net cost contracts, or with large or small bundles of routes, bearing in mind the need to involve small and medium-sized bus operators. But I do agree with the noble lady that any fundamental change to the bus market that is being considered by a local area should take account of the potential effects on competition and the benefits or impacts this could have for bus operators and local people.
It'll be more or less like that, really.
Authorities to work with the Competition and Markets Authority as they develop their proposals, and for the Competition and Markets Authority to be consulted. I therefore again hope that through that reassurance, I'm certainly with her in ensuring that we'll see how that we can figure that fit that in into the proposal within the bill.
Yes. Thank you very much.
In addition, the noble lady Baroness Jones has proposed Amendment 48, which would add some additional requirements to the consultation provisions in relation to franchising, including requiring passenger interest groups to be consulted on franchising proposals.
That has to be said.
I thank the noble lady
for
her amendments
totally
and agree that it's vitally important
exactly
that passenger groups and others that may be affected are fully consulted on proposals to improve local bus services. I recognise that many noble lords have spoken on the subject of passenger representation and accessibility of bus services at second reading and in earlier committee dates, and I fully understand.
Right, there you go. It won't now, because I've turned the bugger down. I has a mixing desk on board now. So that should be better.
Should be better.
I've just got to remember to turn it up again. Who says sound's gone?
Someone without any bloody heroes.
Is that better? That's all better now, is it? Chat will tell us.
Yes. An enhanced partnership proposal should take. The noble lady raised an important issue about accessibility.
The debt is better.
They do blether on, don't they?
They do.
That is accessible to all. I agree that any consultation must give local people due time to consider and respond.
Actually, I've just remembered what I can do.
A large impact.
Turn that
on
up.
Our local communities.
Turn that off. And then it just comes in the background. That's the best way of doing it. Yes, that's the best way of doing it. Yes, I've worked it out now, Wraith. I had this worked out before and then I got it wrong.
We did. What was that?
I have no idea. It was a Dalek, I think. Shall we give everybody a sneak preview of TFV8?
Yeah, go on, I've got one in the box, I can't use it. Oh, Mark, you're ruining it.
He didn't. I clicked myself.
I couldn't see because Mark coming and then took the
hangover. Right. Rest of you, stay quiet.
I've got you locked now.
Here we go. I'll try again.
That's a bit cloudy, that. What's the wattage there, sir?
That's at 101 watts.
101, okay.
Just 101. Seemed reasonable to me.
Oh, yeah.
Thursday, 200.
Go on, do 250.
Why would I want to do 250?
We're doing 200.
You are?
Yeah, 200 is a sensible number, right? 250 is just like this.
250 wattages? I don't think so. Section 123D23, 123D23, 123D23. I wish they'd stop blethering on. No, Morph. Morph, you are considerably wrong.
What?
Really?
Have you seen the Mew Tank yet?
The which one?
The Mew Tank.
No.
Ah, this is the Mew Tank.
And? Clicks on Matt. That's cloudage.
That's like 90 watts, that is.
90 watts. Right, Marco, you brought it up. Turn something up to 250 watts and vape it.
Oh.
I'll do it. You can't see it, but 250 watts. Oh, this is going to be bad.
Everybody ready? Nose hit.
There's one that hit 250 watts, that. Oh, that's rank.
Can't be rank. There is the owner of the only rank tank allowed.
Yes, I have.
Bloody hell, the size of that drip tip.
Pardon?
On these TFV8s.
Oh, it's huge. And it's not a 510 fitting either.
You have to pay a toll to go down there.
Yes, I have seen smaller tunnels and in certain kinds of... never mind. I was going to mention certain kinds of films, but it's not a thing a good boy ought to do, apparently.
No,
absolutely.
Hasn't started yet, London Vapor. It's getting there, though.
In the meantime, we're just fooling around.
It's what we do. Yeah. Oh, by the way, there is a drinking game tonight, everybody.
Oh,
there is a drinking game tonight. Anytime Ash is mentioned, you slurp. If Ash is mentioned, you slurp.
So, it's getting completely pissed tonight, then.
If NNA is mentioned... three slurps. I think it's only fair.
Yes, I'm on non-alcoholic.
Doesn't count. They're overrunning.
Oh. Yeah, they've let her in.
This isn't one of those, what do you call it? Thingamajigs.
Doofle Firkins.
That's the one.
Yeah.
What do they call it? When they...
Talk until they run out of time.
Yes. Yes, what's it called? Filibustering.
Oh, filibuster, yeah.
Filibustering. Or as I've said, being a twat.
Go through these processes again when the franchising scheme is modified.
It's franchising.
I've just used up my TFV8.
Uh-huh. Did you prime it?
Yes, I primed it. I shall give it a moment or two to soak in.
I should. Where are you? For I'm here.
Carrot juice, disco days. Carrot juice.
What?
What the hell's he on about?
Harry says, I have my carrot juice topped up and ready to slurp.
He wants his ass kicked.
I don't think you're drinking carrot juice, are you, Dez? You're drinking some sort of scrappy type stuff, what you've been brewing.
I mean, I could understand it if it was carrot wine, but carrot juice? Corner, now. Can't be having this. VTTV fans and watchers and viewers drinking carrot juice. Bloody hell, man.
It's unholy, is what it is.
It's disgusting.
Scratchings don't go with carrot juice, do they?
It's positively heresy.
Well, that mod's no good, Matt, because you've got bad batteries.
Has anybody seen Callanan yet? In opposition pending government, I have found previous. Carrot juice is homebrew cider, that's all right.
I like rough.
Are you running yet, Matt?
No, I'm just finding another mod which is capable of outputting the required.
Brian Core wants to know, has he got time to voop?
You should have vooped before you started, Brian. Goodness gracious.
Brian, as far as we're concerned, if you want to go for a dry hit, mate, go for a dry hit.
Is that the same as a ghosting?
Kind of. Just take your mobile with you.
I still have a nice 50 watts to break her in.
Go on then. I've clicked you.
Okay. We will see many of the principals embodied in these
amendments in this group. As government amendments. What's working?
Waiting for the flavour to come through, right?
It will. I'm feeling pretty pleased with it. Needs a couple of mil before the flavour really smacks past the new atty taste. Well said, London Vapor. Watch it on a tablet. Take it with you, Brian. Just don't put it on your knees. Favourite drops down the pan.
Well, okay, that seems to be adequate. That's cranker up to 100 then.
Liz, vaping points, says, what do alcoholics like you do? With the drinking game, Liz? Just play the game. Seriously, I don't think we'll go short.
100 glorious wattage.
Go on then, I'll click you. I've clicked you. Nice, isn't it?
Come on, whack up to the max.
It is, it's the DNA 200, it only goes 100 watts in Campbell.
Get it on the road layer of T50 then.
I've got something else on it. I'll do that on Thursday on Dave's show.
It will be a night of cloudage. Yeah. Or a clout of nightage, whichever one you add. I'm not a fan. Yeah. Fetching beer. Yes, don't confuse your tablet paper tablet with toilet paper.
No, give it a shot. Unless you've got one of those nice rounded edgy tablets.
And 75
relate to the time period which must expire before services
are provided
under local service contracts.
They're going into more bloody amendments.
Provides that at least 6 months must expire between a contract being awarded and provision of the relevant service.
We'll translate this. The aim being to provide a suitable period of transition. The franchisee should be told by the franchisor when a franchise is purchased that the franchisee will be subject to the franchisor's franchise rules when the franchise is put into person and acted on by the franchisee under the auspices of the franchisor. The franchisor responsibilities to the franchisee with regard to the franchise are as any franchisee should be able to expect of a franchisor, and the franchise should be franchised to the franchisee by the franchisor under the auspices of the franchise regulation authority.
Yes.
Amendment 76 amends the Local Transport Act 2008.
Seriously.
To remove provisions relating to quality contract schemes.
Yeah.
Which were inserted. Are you enjoying that, Matt?
The BBC elocution colleges. Sorry, well, I didn't get that.
You went elocution. Yes, hello. Hello and welcome to the BBSA. Tonight on tonight's show, we shall be looking at the House of Lords and what they're talking about with regard to electronic cigarettes, which my friend Mr. Shalmundley and I have been using for quite some time. These electronic cigarettes, of course, are meant as a replacement for the tobacco variety, and we've been enjoying many, many marvellous flavours out of the whole shebang. It's an absolutely marvellous technology. Hang on, things might be happening. No, he's got no problem with the amendment as moved by the great lord from Surrey who talks really nice. Chris Bailey's drinking scotch. Dave Newell says we might be a bit early. The regret motions are going to be included in dinner break business, which usually happens around 7:30. But I could we took seven o'clock. We thought it was 7 o'clock, so we were early. But it doesn't matter. It's all right. It's fine.
In the meantime, it just isn't to us back that long.
Well, let's be like proper telly people. I'm going to go to the effervescent loveliness that is the one and only Sav and say, Sav, what would you like to see come out of tonight's debate?
That's a very good question.
That's why I asked it.
I would agree, that's probably why they would ask it. I mean, what we want to see is we're going to come out of tonight's debate. We want to see go back to a field motion, but I can't see that happening.
No, it's a great shame.
It's just a lot of regrets.
Yes.
And that's the story of everyone's life, isn't it? We've all got a lot of regrets, but... So I don't think anyone's going to get ideally what they want, but and this is simply, and I'll be quite open and honest about this. It still has to happen. I still think it's going to be really positive.
I think you're probably right. Hang on a minute. I'm just going to duck the Lords out for it. That's it. That's better. Yes, I think you're probably right. I think lots and lots of regrets is a good thing.
Yeah.
We like that idea. Yes. So, Mark will ban Baston. What would you like to see come out of this?
Say that again, Dave.
What would you like to see coming out of all of these regret motions and things?
Well, as Sav said, it would have been nice for it to have been the full bifter, as you say, and have the whole thing thrown out, which is what it should have been done in the first place. Hopefully, with the backing of as many lords as possible, the government will see that the issue is bigger than maybe they think it is.
That's a good point. Matt, you?
Pretty much what Marco just said. I hope to see some progress tonight in some acknowledgement of the TPD isn't entirely fitting with current research and enlightened timings, shall we say.
Yes. I'm kind of hoping that this whole three regret motions taken one on top of the other, each regretting separate parts of the statutory instrument, that being pushed towards the governing authorities, as it were, the Department of Health and MHRA, and obviously Her Majesty's government, such as it is at the moment, this may well filter through into what's going on Wednesday at Public Health England. The Lord only knows who's going to be there. So we shall see what's going on. They're taking a vote on something now, I think. Let me just check that. Yes, they are moving motions formally. Like Brian Coe.
Hey!
Speaking of Brian Coe, he's just mentioned in chat that he hopes that they take into account the 2,000 messages that were sent to the Lords.
Oh, I sincerely hope that that's the case, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, let's face it, everybody sent something. They're still talking about bus services. What the hell is a bus?
This is now Baroness Jones of Whitechurch, or Whitchurch.
Who is she? What does she do? Why has she got birds on her chest?
Don't know, but she's Labour, apparently.
She's in Labour? She's doing awfully well to be stood at a microphone.
Yeah,
No, Des, I'm not going to show the vid of Subri singing Here Jude. I want to hold on to what little I've had for me tea, thank you. In fact, I'm with what Wraith Tech said. If you're watching this on demand, I shall read it for you. He said, Disco Des, don't need to see that doddery prick on screen anytime soon. That's what he said. Commitment to train and employ a number of long-term unemployed people to work on a contract, or it could include a number of apprenticeships. So there's only two regret motions now. Lord Hunt has changed his to an amendment of Lord Callanan's motion, trying to water it down a bit. Perhaps with some shared. Well, let's hope that amendment gets hoyed open. An environmental plan with targets for green energy and reduce. Oh, you've got a fan, Sav. My lord,
these are just examples. Oh, God.
I'll put you full screen and leave you there then, because
No,
seriously, I don't want to interrupt the lad's pleasure. As long as he's got a box of Kleenex, we're good.
No, you really, really don't want to do that.
28-inch picture of Sav.
That's not nice for anybody to have to put up.
Am I seeing some Apple product placement there, Sav?
Is that?
Over your left shoulder.
Is that my left?
No, you have a left.
The other left.
Yeah, there's a lot of Apple product over there. That.
Yeah, that.
Yeah, that's something.
Our viewing audience won't be able to see that.
Send us lots of stuff.
It's a time capsule. That's what happens.
Oh, you can open the group Peter Garden.
Yes.
All together now.
I stole it.
Where's it saying what did it?
Turning his urn. How is it in the time capsule?
Yeah, everyone that upsets me ends up in the time capsule. It's the new list.
Glenis Willimot is in and says, Happy birthday, Mr. Dawn. I have a G&T in hand in your honour. Thank you, Mrs. Willimot. She's moved. At end, insert 8. The scheme must specify whether consideration is being given to the wider social, economic and environmental benefits of the scheme in accordance with the Public Services Social Value Act 2012.
Oh, Wraith Tech, how many times did I just say that statement's very wrong? I'm not going to.
Just did.
Like a NAS, but rubbish.
Yeah. It depends what one expects from the device one has, doesn't it?
Well, I know what my wife expects from my device.
Yes. Which is really about extending the
ambition of the bill. That's all. Nothing more. Whether it's environmental or social.
And it was only because the inspiration. Do you think we're going to keep it going until about 10 to 11? Because this goes on to 11 o'clock.
What does?
I'll tell you what, I doubt this Lord session goes on to 11.
Well, if
the truth there, Rafe, is don't buy some shit from Buffalo.
If they're still talking e-cigs at 11, I'll be here. Yes, Tony P says up there in Manchester it's a buzz.
I'm going to type this into chat because I'm not going to put it on here.
Very wise. And my naval friend Baroness Jones. That camera angle that's currently on is shocking. Description of what one might be looking for.
All these amendments basically cover the same thing, but it is. Needs a bit of foundation on his pate.
No, it's not that. There's a bloody microphone lead hanging down the middle. When people look and see. If you look at it, look. There's a blurry bit right down the middle of the screen, the microphone lead. He keeps sticking his head behind it. He looks silly. The government will, in these amendments
or something similar, realise. All right. By his head.
Yes. So that's just really poor depth of field. Now they've heard and they're moving it. The Houses of Parliament are tuned into VTTV to see what we see. Your cameraman are crap!
Right, I've got it all on one screen now.
You'll really get some benefit out of that. Now, these two amendments in 58B and
58C? I don't know.
We mentioned.
Who's Roy Hodgson, please?
England, ex-England manager.
Is he deprecated, is he?
When he resigned after the debacle that was England Euro.
Yeah, after England came to Iceland. Just as well, they would have got hammered by Morrison's in the next round.
Morrison's?
Well, they couldn't beat Iceland.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, it's been a good day today. Farage has resigned from UKIP. Chris Evans has resigned from Top Gear. So nice, we've got a good day.
there's bound to be a third one. I'm just wondering what it's going to be. What's going to be the third resignation today?
But if the information was there, then I think an enormous benefit local communities, small communities, especially in the country, countryside, would
I like what Graham's just typed. Nobody needs that much locally stored porn. Does 3 petabytes count? And that's just the dwarf porn, and everybody knows those file sizes are smaller.
Why?
No, SVDD is not planning to resign.
Who's Dave Kay?
I think it's Dave Kay's brother.
Mike Dobbs' cousin. Who the hell said 7 o'clock?
I blame Radio.
I'm going to blame Liam because he's in chat right now.
Is he? Right, it's his fault.
Yeah.
Would have been better if it had been Radio because then we could have taken the piss out of his accent.
Well, Radio backed it up.
Did he? Who's up past 7? Is it 7 o'clock then?
There we go.
Whose watch is this iPad? Whose court is this jacket? Whose condom is this balloon? Haven't I? Isn't it? Couldn't I? Wouldn't it?
Just trying to see if there's any indication as to when it's going to be, but it doesn't appear to be any indication time-wise.
Well, we'll just sit here and fill 5 minutes till it starts.
It appears to be the last thing on the agenda, though.
Oh, Jesus.
After oral question 4 instructing NHS England to use pre-exposure prophylaxis for patients with HIV, Lord Hunt of King's Heath.
I've met him.
Who's this chap now? Do we know?
Baldy McBaldface? I don't know.
That would be Lord Baldy McBaldface.
Sorry. Viscount Baldy of Baldyface. Let's talk about e-cigs.
Yeah. Yes. That's what we do on this show, isn't it?
I tell you what we'll do. We'll do that thing I did before. We'll go and see what everybody's using. So, Marco, you're up first. What you got in your hand, mate? What you vaping on?
Well, right this minute, I've got the TFRTA on a relay, 60 watts, with black and blue by Tea Juice that I made myself. Yeah.
Demonstration, please. No time for the minister to consider the advice of officials.
Nice.
Okay. And next we move to the bountiful beautylicious and effervescent loveliness that is the one and only self.
8 yards, I am using a crown on a cuboid at apparently 50 watts. I don't do clouds, it is jam toast that I made myself.
Okay, give us a gentle poof.
I give you a cloudlet.
A cloudlet, a gentle poof. I thought you said it was a gentle cloudlet.
It is, I'm just really close to the camera.
Yeah, you see, I'll put your prayers and you'll whistle them in Serbo Croat. Matt, what you got?
Lots of things. I will go for the TFV8, I think, because it's fun. It's good, big fun. We just compound the problem of our individualistic society. There's a little gentle cloudlet.
Gentle cloudlets. I myself this evening, I'm on a Hell's Gate TC200. I was on the Relais earlier on, but I managed to batten the flatteries, as you do. Currently running a TFV8 with the 8-coil core thing, doodah, in the what's its name. At 101 watts, on the basis that I thought it might make the clouds look like Dalmatians. Here we go. It's crap. Puts nowt away. Comments?
Lacking there, isn't it? Yeah. One has to ask, though, of the Honourable Mr. Dawn,
yeah.
What on earth would be in that e-juice to produce Dalmatians?
Ah, well, it's pure evil Scream Queen is what's in there. Currently running at 3 milligrams, and this morning when I attached the device to the device and sat to voop, as one does first thing on a morning, I actually got a buzz. Followed swiftly by beep, 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 as I set the bloody smoke alarms off again. Which is why I'm sweating.
I thought he was going to say you followed swiftly by a splash.
Well, there was that. There was that, but the beep, 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 beep. Yeah, got shot of that. Yes. So I've got the door shut tonight on the basis that if I don't, I'll set the bloody alarms off again. This thing smacks it out. It's ridiculous. I love it. I got a buzz. Stays. Yes, declick yourself, David. Nobody wants to see you mirrored. Whoa! Top of Mark Wars head. Then Matt coughed.
Yes, I just thought I'd put some more juice in this pro tank.
I'm going to run through what our audience is using. Where are we? Bruni started going bald at 18. That's got nothing to do with vaping. F1 Annette is a Serpent Mini in Pico and a Plato with the Triton 1.2 ohm coil at around 16 watts. Leanna Lawless has a boring cuboid and cubis. She's not easily pleased. Zero Vapes.
She's not anything else.
No. Zero Vapes has a Sigelli 213 with Ewell crown at 50 watts using Mad Mike's After Party Liquid. He's thinking of switching to the Mellow 3 Mini with the fried Oreo liquid in. Disco Dez is on
fried
a Kanga.
Oreo.
Yeah. Disco Dez is on a Kanga Tech dripper box with Elements Pink Lemonade and God knows at what watts. If you look at the display, it'll tell you.
Brian Cohn's got a griffin of two coils that are fighting each other.
Really?
Oh. Yeah. Dual coils, apparently.
Ah. London. London Vapor's got a Troll V2 on the RX200 at 75 watts with Forbidden Flavors Sensei's Morning Tea. Vaping Point, Liz, is a Tesla Stealth and three other devices. No. You can't just say three other devices. They have to be mentioned. It's got to be typed out. Not to promote anything, but if anybody's reading chat. Where are we? PSA. From John Summers. GQ Vapes Caviar, supposed to be a coffee cream vape, don't bother. If it's called caviar, it's going to taste of fish.
You think, wouldn't
you? You would. Adam, you... Yes, eggy fish, or fishy eggs. It's not good either way you slice it. G-Prof Squonker with an HF Predator at 35 watts, that's Adam UKVT. Tony P has a Serpent Mini on a Pico, Annette. I think there should be a comma. A Serpent Mini on a Pico, Annette. Unless Annette's got a much smaller sister with the same name. Miles Dolphins is on a cuboid and a Smock GCT with homebrew. Beer. Sean O'Toole's an RX200S and a G2 TF RTA with pink man. Silent 79's on an RX200 clear to a pancake man. Rafe Tech's an Ely 50-watt Nautilus X TC100 mid Griffin in SS316 temperature control.
Liz, GG stuff mentioned earlier.
I'm getting there. Vaping point. Liz is our own mix on 4 and a vamp vape on a mini curve. Reptile Keeper, Kraken Hansel's Folly is very nice. Paul Robinson, Griffin 25 on the Rolo with strawberry cream. Blaze is a Zephyrus on a VTC mini being favoured at the moment with a raspberry blueberry mix. Annette's using our own mix apple. Brian Coe's on a Sigelli 150TC, Griffin 25mm dual coil, Clapton's custard Irish cream, butterscotch. Butterscotch? Ah, oh, yes. Guaranteed to wipe the Klingons off Uranus. Bruni's a cuboid with cubist grayscale strawberry lemonade. Rafe Tech says, hurrah, masturbation jokes. Wanker. Divinity Well, he's in Hartlepool, you know. Sigelli 213 with limitless RDTE use. What are you laughing at?
Nothing, you carry on.
Hesty the Mage is a limitless RDTE on a home slice at 460 Fahrenheit, homemade dragon fruit strawberry. That sounds interesting. Where are we? Justin Powers, RX200S with clear to at 65 watt use in Hell's Kitchen. Morph is on a clear to at 50 watts on the mini VTC with fresh squeeze from Element. Disco Dez is a plus EVIC VTTC with an Ego 1 mega 0.5 ohm cancel coil at 20 watts with 3 milligram home mixed red Astaire. He just types a lot. Distant Scouse, I've got it now. Crown 1 on an RX200. Juice, Scouse, juice. Which juice? Paul Scher, Exvo Pro with a Bachelor Tank and Mr. Brunch. Rob Typhi's Red Astaire on a Smock TFR DTR on the RX200. Hang on, you were right. This is a blast from the past. Mark Magenis, Magenis, Magenis. I should know. GGTS and IATI, GGTS and ODI, GGTS and UFS with Cisco low resistance. My God, that's a blast from the past. What do you make of that, Sav?
That really is a blast from the past. Wow, you must have the patience of a saint to put all that stuff together.
It's finding the O-rings.
Yes, the 2 million of them.
Yes, you need to count the O-rings, Mark, and tell us how many it needs. Very boring's on an RX200, Cryos V3, 240 degrees centigrade. You European. Zero Vapes, Fried Oreo is bloody lovely, right? KF15 on a cuboid for Dave Newell, Day and Gloss. Anthony Peter CR1, Cool Fire 4, Lemon Lush from Demon Vapor. Gary Dibley's got a Cleto SS on temperature 50 watts, 540 with Rude Oil Pump 2.
Ah, that's good stuff, that pump too.
What's the Rude Oil? Don't answer. It's yeah. Gary. It's Gary. Don't tell me. Graham.
It's a tea juice. Pump 1 and pump 2.
I see. Graham. Nice. GGE, Graham Gord's Entwistle, is on the same thing he's used for over a year, and I've tried that, and it's lovely. Where are we at? Oh, they're scrolling off faster. I can get there. Spirit is Vapes, you know, as we're waiting for the Lords, I'm going to get this Camry K100 and Igo L setup that I just found. Going back again. Synonym, Flamet and Butler. Don't shoot. Won't shoot. TFRT on the RX200 with hand-mixed Mythical Mists, Pegasus and Billow V3. On the cuboid with one-shot Wonder Mighty Melons at the Moor. Can somebody take over?
Go on in.
Go on in. There you go.
Right, so... Rob EIFI, when one of your kids leave home, God. Okay, my vaping place. KFM4 clone on an Ely TC200, 25 watts, 440 degrees, with Ben Brew juice. What flavour, though? What flavour? And, oh, let's see. I'm just trying to see who else has got stuff. Cool Vibe, Cuboid, Dolina, Billow V3 with Mod Milk Strawberry and a Dripbox 160 with My Man. That's a one-hit wonder, isn't it, My Man?
Yes.
I've got the T-shirt. Yeah, I've got the T-shirt. I've not tried the juice.
That's lovely.
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah,
Dripbox has a squonk-modded velocity. Scone.
Spirit as Vip says masturbation jokes. You'll never pull that off, DD.
I've heard he does.
I'm just a little prick.
Bruning is now on favourite tank Atlantis with an ice stick 50 watt Grayscale's raspberry lemonade. Richard Bennett, RX 200 times 2, both of the avocados, 1 with joust, 1 with berry cheesecake. So 1 with joust, 1 with berry cheesecake. Dan Sirs, K-Fun Mini V3 with RY Haw, 0 milligrams. No idea what that one is.
RY Haw.
Just make it RY Haw.
Yeah.
Who is it?
Yes.
Raytech, Sluice Juice Gold Stash, a rather nice vanilla custard. More custard than vanilla.
Ooh.
It's lovely stuff. Yeah. Mrs. Vicky Caramel, a Veritas 0.4 ohm on a slug with Black Betty.
Whoa, Black Betty! Bam a lamb! Whoa, Black Betty!
I knew he would do that. Ben Lockwood is on a Wismec RX 200 Crown Tank with Heisenberg.
Heisenberg, yes.
And Leanna Hollis has got some mother's milk in a cubis on an EVIC VT Mini, and an RX 200 with Hurricane in a cubis, and an RY4 in a Nautilus on an IPV3S. Raytech again, vampire vapes attraction in the Northwest because throw tip from the 4060. Let's go down. Vonk 7. The VTC Mini subtank, 220 degrees Celsius DIY hot napalm, 9 milligram. Hot napalm, what is that flavour? Do tell.
I think it's. I think that's one of the ones that he had across in Warsaw, which I may well have tried. Yeah. Yes, it smelled gorgeous, tasted divine. Vonk's got great taste buds.
Mmm. Chris Berry's back. He's got an RX 200 avocado 24 with posh GU berry.
Ew.
Ew. Posh GU berry. My vaping place, vanilla raspberry Soho brackets tobacco. What else have we got?
Sticky. Go on.
Sticky. Lost the idea. Here, an RX 200 dripping blue haze CBD liquid. Happy days. Peace out.
Peace on. Peace off. Who cares?
Aaron Jammy's on a Diablo mech mod. 0.6 alien coil. Chuffing French dude. He's chuffing a French dude. Ultimate 230 watts.
What frequency?
That stuff. Do you know what I've mentioned, I think?
Yeah, you have. Yeah, you've got all, haven't you?
Hang on. To move the motion standing in my name. Right, we're on.
Okay, let's
go. Tobacco products directive gives me a curious sense of déjà vu. Before I arrived in this house, I was a member of the European Parliament, where I also opposed these restrictions alongside a number of other MEPs from many varied parties and nations. We did make some improvements to the text, but we were unsuccessful in our aim of removing vaping devices from the directive altogether. I never imagined at the time that I would have the opportunity to return to the subject in this house. 8 weeks ago, a number of us gathered in the Moses Room to debate a motion on this subject, tabled by my noble friend, Viscount Ridley. Everyone that spoke in that debate, including, to his enormous credit, the Minister, expressed considerable concern about these regulations, since it was self-evident that neither the government nor the opposition thought this was a helpful package of measures. I put down a motion for a prayer of annulment. Nobody likes these rules, so why implement them? I quickly realised, of course, that I was straying into controversial constitutional territory, although given some recent events, a mere fatal motion in this House looks like a rather inconsequential intrusion on the constitutional landscape of this country. My Lords, e-cigarettes are by far the most popular gateway out of tobacco for our nation's 9 million smokers. Some 100,000 of us die every year from smoking. This is a Hillsborough every 8 hours. As my more scientifically literate friends will no doubt explain, it is the smoke that kills and not the nicotine. There is now emphatic evidence of how much safer vaping is than smoking. Numerous studies have shown that vaping is 95% safer than tobacco smoking. In the UK now, 2.8 million people have either stopped smoking or reduced smoking significantly because a direct result of vaping. Yet, given all of that evidence, these regulations will reduce by 95% the number of products on the market, ban the stronger liquids favoured by many vapers, and ban virtually all forms of advertising to prevent suppliers from recruiting new smokers to the vaping cause. So how have we ended up with this crazy state of affairs? The Department of Health prides itself on being a global thought leader, to use their words, on tobacco. And whilst the department have played a strong game on pure control measures, by which I mean the ban on public place smoking and the taxation of smoking, it has been little short of appalling in its approach to tobacco harm reduction, by which I refer to the development of much less harmful substitutes to smoking. And there are two particularly egregious failures on the policy treatment of these smoking substitutes. The first occurred when the Minister of Public Health was one Edwina Curry. In 1988, in a moment of unhelpful decisiveness, she pushed through a ban on a product commonly called snus. This is an oral tobacco product which is a bit like sucking a tea bag of tobacco leaves. If you haven't tried it, I wouldn't recommend it. 4 years later, the EU decided to also adopt a ban. And the only exception to that ban is Sweden, which negotiated an opt-out in the run-up to its referendum on joining the EU. Now, being permitted in one EU country but banned everywhere else provides us with a perfect case study of harm reduction measures. Because of the widespread use of snus, Sweden has by far the lowest smoking rates in Europe, 11% compared with the EU average of 26%. All the major forms of cancer are far lower, disease rates correlating with the lowest disease rates correlating with the highest use of snus. The European Journal of Epidemiology has estimated that 200,000 lives could be saved every year if the EU had the same male smoking prevalence as Sweden, yet the product is banned because of us. A second major blunder has, of course, been with the much more modern substitute of e-cigarettes. Here, the Department of Health's medicines agency, the MHRA, tried to ban them outright in 2010. It failed, so it tried again in 2013, declaring that they should all be medicines. And despite its opposition to commercially regulated e-cigarettes, the MHRA has failed to get even one medicinally regulated e-cigarette onto the market during the last 3 years, whereas the current commercial market has currently managed to produce about 25,000 product varieties. The 2.8 million vapers using them are not smoking literally billions of tobacco cigarettes. Displaying a somewhat marvellous gift for understatement, the Royal College of Physicians this year declared that the MHRA's policy has been, quotes, counterproductive to public health. However, in 2013, the Department of Health then lobbied vigorously in Brussels for a Europe-wide policy of compulsory medicinal regulation. Whilst I and my former colleagues, as I said earlier, in the European Parliament, were able to ameliorate this policy, there was only a limited amount of change that we could get through, hence the very flawed package that we are reviewing today. Economic modelling suggests that just one of the measures, the ban on stronger e-cigarettes, will cost more than 100,000 lives a year around the EU. And not only was it a disastrous policy, it was also a disastrous policy process. In 2013, the then Public Health Minister, one Anna Soubry, appeared before the European Scrutiny Committee to explain why she had decided to use a scrutiny override without informing other departments when she voted for this directive on behalf of the UK government. The minister told the committee in her evidence that e-cigarettes had in fact been excluded from the directive. My lords, they had not. Now, if my noble friends can cope with viewing this cringe-making performance, as you can imagine, it is widely available on YouTube. And this level of competence was not just evidenced at ministerial level. The chief medical officer declared to the New Scientist a few months later that e-cigarettes were one of the three biggest health threats to the UK, along with obesity and binge drinking. My lords, it would be funny if the issue was not so serious. So what are the lessons from these two major policy areas from the Department of Health, which are literally costing us thousands of lives in this country? The first, of course, is the need for strong political leadership in the department. It is no good for the Secretary of State, who has presided over this latest debacle, to keep his head well down. The new Prime Minister needs to recruit a real talent into the role of the Minister for Public Health. The other issue that needs looking at very hard is the role of the MHRA in policy development. It is a fact that this agency derives most of its revenue from the pharmaceutical industry. It is also clear that it has lobbied very hard for a land grab on e-cigarettes, and yet has signally failed to deliver them into any product available to consumers. Ministers should be extremely cautious about listening to its lobbying. And let me give you my favourite example of the way the MHRA is implementing these regulations. Many suppliers sell refillable e-cigarettes, which are sold empty, ready for consumers to use their own e-liquid in them. A number of retailers told me that the MHRA were instructing them to affix warning labels to these products, saying that they contain nicotine, which of course they don't at the point of sale. Now, I assume my correspondents must be exaggerating, they got their facts wrong, so I obtained an official copy of the MHRA guidance. Let me quote from the section labelled, section headed Labelling Your Products. I quote, "If your product does not contain nicotine when sold, but can be used to contain nicotine, the warning statement, 'This product contains nicotine, which is a highly addictive substance,' must be applied." It then goes on to helpfully state, "To provide clarity to consumers, we recommend adjacent wording, brackets, not part of the fixed boxed warning, to the effect that the warning applies when the product is used as designed and filled with nicotine-containing liquid." In other words, firstly, you have to falsely label the product contains nicotine when it doesn't, and then you have to clarify to consumers that the product will contain nicotine as soon as they put some nicotine liquid in it. My lords, the MHRA, I don't know whether to laugh or to cry, but passing regulations such as this, in my view, seriously brings the law into disrepute. And now, bizarrely, whilst doing their best to restrict the sales of one tobacco substitute, which of course costs taxpayers nothing, we are actually heavily subsidising nicotine-containing gum and patches, since they are given out on prescription. The difference, of course, is that these products are made by the big pharmaceutical companies, which appear to have the Department of Health as a sort of wholly owned subsidiary. These companies stand to lose large amounts of money as sales of their nicotine substitutes have collapsed with the advent of e-cigarettes. The pharmaceutical industry uses its massive spending power to manipulate the harm reduction debates. It funds conferences, so-called medical charities, and quasi-academic research to justify its position. If the Department of Health is to improve its performance on tobacco harm reduction, it needs to be just as cautious with its dealings with the big pharmaceutical companies and their allies as it is with the tobacco industry itself. It is this poverty of performance by the Department of Health which led my noble friend Lord Prior to confess to the House, if it hadn't been for the moderating effect of Brussels, that the new regulations could have been, quote, far worse. This, of course, is a very difficult issue for a Brexiteer like myself to confront. Now, certainly and somewhat unjustly, the EU has been on the receiving end of anger over the e-cigarette regulations. One poll found a very large majority for Brexit among vapers who said they were angry with the regulations because of what they perceived to be excessive influence from the big companies. Some of my noble friends might even wonder whether Anna Soubry, in her role as public health minister, was in fact a sleeper agent for Vote Leave. So where should policy go from now? Well, contrition from my noble friend the Minister is welcome. The key is to take concrete steps, of course, to improve the situation. Critical issues which I would ask the Minister to respond to this evening include measures to rebuild consumer confidence in e-cigarettes. Smokers who do not vape currently perceive e-cigarettes to be much more dangerous than scientists say they in fact are. We need serious action and not just a few warm words. And we also need a clear plan to put into production medicinal supplies of stronger e-liquid, which is used by a quarter of a million vapers in this country, including my noble friend Earl Cathcart. It would be unconscionable if the MHRA was to fail once again on this. The need is simple. Several suppliers of base e-liquids approved by the MHRA before Christmas, please. And now that we are going to be leaving the EU, we have the opportunity to make regulations that will be evidence-based and create a climate in which smokers can quit for safer products. We need to remove the ridiculous restrictions on product choice and advertising of e-cigarettes and other reduced-harm products like heat not burn. To this end, I welcome the Treasury's consultation on the taxation of heated products later this year. Finally, there is the global policy-making role of the Department. When the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control meets in India later this year, I hope that we will see them considering a Department of Health advocacy paper on harm reduction that is free from the commercial interests of the pharmaceutical industries. My Lords, I beg to move the motion.
The question is that this motion be agreed to. Amendment, Lord Hunter of King's Heath.
My Lords, first of all, I would like to welcome this debate and thank the noble Lord for allowing us to have a further go at this, since we've already debated in Grand Committee. I'm sure the noble Lord, the Minister, is looking forward to winding up at the end of the debate. My Lords, I should declare an interest as President of the Royal Society of Public Health, since the RSPH has actually pronounced on e-cigarettes. And I should say to the noble Lord, since he was, I think, a mite critical of the organisation, I did establish as a Minister the MHRA. And I'm glad to see that it's doing so well in relation to this matter. My Lords, I would also just observe that I liked the noble Lord's rousing endorsement of the record of ministers in his government in relation to this. And he mentioned Edwina Curry. I thought he was going to talk about eggs, because he will recall, my Lords, that she had a bit of a downer on egg production as well, but I think didn't quite take that to Europe in the way he suggested. My Lords, let me say at once that I've moved an amendment because I share some of the noble Lord's concerns about these regulations in relation to e-cigarettes. The problem I have with his own motion is that he calls on the government to withdraw the entire regulations. And actually, my Lords, if noble Lords look at the regulations, of course it covers e-cigarettes, but it also covers a lot of useful measures which will, I think, discourage smoking in general. And that, my Lords, is why I can't really support the noble Lord. I do, though, share some of his concerns. I think, my Lords, it's pretty clear from the work of my own organisation, the Royal Society of Public Health, also the Royal College of Physicians and other health bodies, that actually e-cigarettes can be an incredibly useful tool in encouraging smokers to give up smoking. And very often, my Lords, the core of people who have already taken advantage of e-cigarettes are often the people whom traditional public health measures have actually not touched. This is why I'm particularly concerned as to whether the regulations are going to have a negative impact on that group of people. Equally, noble Lords, I know, will quote from the Royal College of Physicians. It's worth reading their report, because they do say that there is some case for there to be some regulatory provisions, which no doubt the noble Lord, the Minister, will refer to. But my main concern is actually the point raised by the noble Lord, which is the research by the RSPH, which revealed that 90% of the public actually have the impression that e-cigarettes are at least as harmful as tobacco. And this is not helped because some organisations have notices which actually prohibit not just smoking, but vaping as well. And I think, my Lords, because some elements in the public health field, how shall I put it kindly, perhaps got the wrong end of the stick when e-cigarettes were first produced, it has given the impression that actually e-cigarettes are much more harmful than they actually are. And I think, my Lords, the problem with the regulations is that they kind of colour the context in which the public may be confused about the positive effect that e-cigarettes can have. So, my Lords, my motion, and I don't intend to delay the House very long, my motion seeks to draw attention to some of the concerns that we have about the regulations on e-cigarettes. We wish to see that the regulations as a package introduced. But, my lords, I also wanted to draw attention to the other problem that we have with the government's current policies on smoking cessation, which is that the budgets going particularly to local authorities have actually been drastically reduced. And we have seen a drastic reduction in smoking cessation services. I mean, just as an example, my lords, the amount of money that has been spent on media campaigns in relation to smoking cessation has been drastically reduced. A figure of 24.91 million was spent in 2009-10. That has reached 5.3 million in 2015-16. Now, of course, my lords, I understand budgetary constraints, but I would also say that because of the risk of confusion by the public over e-cigarettes, actually, some Department of Health-sponsored public campaigning is actually necessary to get the right facts across to the public. So, yeah.
I was grateful to the noble lord. He said he couldn't support my noble friend's motion because it referred to all the regulations. Why then does his amendment not simply seek to delete parts 6 and 7 and 8 of the regulations? And which parts of the regulations as they stand does he not agree with?
Well, I rather thought my motion rather elegantly dealt with the broad principles, my lords, than going into such technical details as to which particular paragraph I don't like. I'm disappointed by the noble lord's intervention on that matter. No doubt he is stunned by the remarks of his noble friend that, in fact, the EU came to the rescue of the UK. Because we know, my lords, that if the EU had not actually legislated in this area, the government certainly would have actually brought in legislation much earlier, and it would be much more draconian than the regulations that are before us in the House tonight. We, of course, will be able to see, no doubt, in the future, what a government would do in the event of Brexit. But of course, my lords, at the moment, I think, to be fair, we are debating these regulations. They've actually come into force. And I think, my lords, that what I've attempted to do is to signal some concerns that I have that this would have a negative impact on the use of e-cigarettes without actually detracting from the overall regulations. My lords, I beg to move.
The original question was the motion in the name of Lord Callanan be agreed to. Since when an amendment has been moved by Lord Hunt of King's Heath, as set out on the order paper. The question I therefore have to put is that this amendment be agreed to.
My lords, I was most interested in the noble lord, Lord Callanan's speech, and in particular, his gallant admiration of his colleague, the public health minister, who in my experience has usually been quite on top of her brief. I would perhaps venture to warn the noble lord never to make a mistake in your lordship's house, because I suspect Facebook might be watching. I was also very moved by his defence of the, it was quite tear-jerking, his defence of the discrimination against the multi-billion pound tobacco companies compared to the multi-billion pound pharmaceutical companies. My lords, I agree with much of what has been said by the noble lord Callanan and the noble lord, Lord Hunt of King's Heath, about the desirability of encouraging smokers to give up smoking. There is no doubt that vaping devices have an enormous role to play in this campaign, as many former smokers have managed to give up through using them. However, the regulations we're discussing tonight are not just about vaping devices, but they, as the noble lord, Lord Hunt has pointed out, include standardised packaging regulations, which are essential for ensuring the effectiveness of the health information and warnings on cigarette packs. And they also help enable the UK to meet its obligations as a party to the World Health Organization's Framework Convention on Tobacco Control with respect to tobacco packaging and labelling and product regulation. My lords, there is no doubt that vaping devices have already been an enormous benefit to public health, or I fail to see, however, why we need 25,000 different kinds of them. And they've saved the NHS a great deal of money. When the directive to which these regulations give effect was first discussed in the European Parliament, as has been said, the Liberal group, which contained at that time several Liberal Democrat MEPs, worked hard to ensure that while the regulation of tobacco packaging continued to be robust, the regulations about vaping devices would be proportionate. Given that the original proposals followed the World Health Organization's recommendation that these products should be licensed as medicines and would therefore be extremely tightly regulated, the Liberal group had some considerable success in making them a bit more proportionate, resulting in the directive as it is now. However, one of the things on which the group was not successful was the prohibition of commercial advertising of vaping products. My Lord, this is the major item contained in my regret motion. We've heard that according to the Royal College of Physicians, vaping is 95% less harmful than smoking, and that half of all smokers die from diseases that result from smoking. That is why it's vital that smokers can get information about these products and their benefits. And I regret very much that publicity about them is to be restricted. I do, however, support the noble Lord Lord Hunt in his call for a new public information programme to inform smokers of the benefits of switching to e-cigarettes. It may surprise your lordships to know that half of smokers are not aware of how much safer for their health e-cigarettes are. And I also agree with Lord Hunt in regretting the cutting of smoking cessation services, one of the many results from the public health funding cuts, which I and others have condemned many times in your lordship's house. My lords, I suppose one of the reasons for the advertising ban is the fear that advertising will attract young people to start vaping, even though they have never smoked. This, of course, is undesirable because nicotine vapour is very addictive, and I would not want to see children being attracted to spend their money on something so addictive and with no known benefits to their health. Indeed, more research needs to be done about the effect of nicotine inhalation combined with the various flavouring chemicals used in e-cigarettes. There is some evidence emerging that some of the flavourings may be harmful to the delicate cells lining the lungs if inhaled. But, my lords, although e-cigarettes have been around for years, there is no significant evidence that they are attracting non-smokers to take them up. On the other hand, we now have a large and growing cohort of people who use vaping devices, which is why I call on the government to fund research on the benefits and, if there are any, dangers of vaping. Everything should be done to encourage smokers to switch to vaping, which is why my motion also regrets that little attention has been paid to those vapers who claim that they need the higher end concentration of nicotine products, which would be banned by some of these regulations, to help them give up smoking. Only time will tell whether that is the case. That is why the government needs to monitor and report on the implementation of these regulations and their impact on public health. While the further regulations on cigarette packaging are likely to be good, those on vaping devices could turn out to be bad. So, my lords, like the noble Lord Lord Hunt, I do not support Lord Callanan's motion that the government should withdraw all these regulations because we need the ones that affect tobacco. However, although I sincerely regret the government's current intention to withdraw from the European Union in the fullness of time, and hope very much that it never happens, the current situation does give us an opportunity. As things stand, we are not able to keep the good tobacco regulations and ditch the undesirable ones, but the forthcoming negotiations do give us an opportunity to do a bit of cherry picking. So I would like to ask the Minister, what is the government's intention in relation to these and other EU regulations? Does it plan to adopt them all and then repeal the ones it doesn't like? If so, I call on the government to consider carefully any deterrent to smokers switching that might result from these regulations and repeal the ones that deter them as soon as possible. Of course, that would require careful monitoring and publication of the results. On the other hand, if the government plans, in the unlikely event that the government plans to repeal all EU regulations and then adopt new UK ones, I would call on them to replace only the ones that affect tobacco packaging and marketing to further decrease the public health burden of tobacco and the terrible effects on the health of individuals and the NHS. My Lords, given that all these regret motions are non-fatal, I do not intend to vote on mine. Though if the noble Lord Lord Callanan votes on his, my colleagues and I will vote against it. My Lords, we are where we are. What matters now is what the government does in future. Lives depend on it.
Thank you. My Lords, in February 1996, I found myself under the surgeon's knife on the slab at St. Bartholomew's Hospital in London, having a tumour on my lung removed, an operation in which I lost half of my lung capacity, leaving it impossible for me now to walk upstairs or walk any great distance. And the reason for all this was that for 25 years I smoked cigarettes. And I only wish that these new inventions which now exist had been available to me. I tried hypnosis on Harley Street. I tried patches of different forms. I couldn't quite do cold turkey, but I tried everything possible to stop smoking, and it was utterly impossible. Mm-hmm. Indeed, I had my last cigarette the night before they took out the tumour. That's how addicted I was to tobacco. Now, with that in mind, and knowing of my particular difficulties, a gentleman in the north of England wrote me a letter. And I want to really take out the salient points of his correspondence and bring them to the attention of the House, because he manufactures the product. And he says, we have 3 shops and 6 employees. We are manufacturing the liquid that is used in the devices. We've sold thousands of these devices locally, that's to say in the north of England, and helped so many people make the switch. This has been such a rewarding and positive part of the business for myself and staff, who still love helping people to remove a lifelong use of tobacco and improve their health. And if those who are listening to my contribution this evening can hear my heavy breathing, it is as a result of that operation which took place as a result of smoking all those years ago. In his letter, he says that the 2-milliliter tank restriction size is pointless and restrictive on future product development. I wonder if the Minister might deal with these matters in the wind-up, and if he's unable to do so because some of it's technical, then perhaps he could write to me and give me a greater explanation. He says that limiting of nicotine strength to 20 milligrams per milliliter is counterproductive, as it removes the 24 milligram strength, which is essential to lots of new switches. He says the restriction of bottle size to 10 millimetres is pointless, as much more hazardous household products are available in much bigger sizes. The popular size for cost effectiveness and suitability is 30 millilitre, with bottles of 100 millilitre available too. People can average, he tells me, 10 millilitres per day liquid usage. So a restriction on supply there is again counterproductive. There will be a restrictive cost to introduce new products to the market. Remember, he's a manufacturer. And we will be classed as a producer when importing goods from outside the European Union with MHRA notification and testing cost implications to bear. Therefore, a lack of suitable and effective products will be removed from the market. We are looking at having to find the cost of emissions and toxicology data requested per flavour, SKU, for our own manufactured liquids. This is estimated at £5,000 each per flavour, of which we have 20. £5,000 per flavour, of which we have 20. Plus notification and data submissions for any variables of strength would also be required. He says, our business model could be changed from a manufacturer to a retailer.
with loss of jobs and future investments stifled if we are unable to bear the cost of this directive's implementation. We can already see a burgeoning black market, which the TPD Article 20 will encourage, a black market, which the TPD Article 20 will encourage. Individuals are now making liquid at home and selling to whoever they please, with no testing done or age restrictions adhered to or tax paid. I'd have thought that's particularly relevant in this debate. This is not a tobacco product, he says, and should not be classed as such. Doing so is disingenuous and misleading, with implications for people's health. He finally says, we hope you can recognise the huge potential to save millions of lives and the health revolution this presents to governments the world over. I do hope the government will find a way of re-examining these regulations. We potentially could do a lot of damage to a lot of people.
I refer to my interest in the Register, and perhaps particularly that until last month I was chair of the Board of Science for the British Medical Association. Lord Callanan's motion states that the regulations run counter to advice from the Royal College of Physicians to promote vaping, and that they could force vapers back to smoking. Noble Lord should be aware that the Royal College of Physicians does not support the motion. The Royal College of Physicians, together with ASH, BMA, Cancer UK, the Royal Society of Public Health and the UK Centre for Tobacco and Alcohol Studies, all support the TRPR, including the regulation of e-cigarettes. Yes, medical organisations such as the RCP and the BMA recognise a substantial harm reduction offered by e-cigarettes, but they also conclude that they are not harmless. Both identify the need for regulation of e-cigarettes to protect the public. Now, Noble Lords may have received some very inaccurate briefings, making some assertions which are just not substantiated by the evidence. For example, nicotine itself is not dangerous. It's just not true. It is both toxic and addictive. And although vaping using electronic cigarettes is much less harmful than smoking, nicotine itself is toxic. And it's also not helpful if you're going to have surgery. It's not helpful when it's swallowed, it's harmful, and when it's in contact with the skin. And its addictive properties, for me as a psychiatrist, are particularly of concern. It's just not true that the limits of 20 milligrams per mil will force many vapors to return to smoking. Use of high-strength nicotine is not the norm. And anyway, vapers who need more nicotine can get it by vaping more frequently. It's not true that the regulations mean no advertising. Substantial forms of advertising would still be permitted under the regulations. It is true. There are substantial, I won't go into the list of them. Well, okay. Point of sale, on billboards, on buses, as inserts in printed media, and the provision of product information on websites. Furthermore, the ASH YouGov results show that over 90% of smokers are now aware of e-cigarettes. So existing smokers already know about vaping. It's the non-smokers who we don't want to become addicted to nicotine who are not so aware. I will certainly allow you.
Could you explain to me why it's okay to advertise on the side of a bus, but not to advertise in a newspaper?
I don't have an explanation for the kinds of advertising that have been approved or not approved, but some advertising is still permitted. And the information which is being put out is that no advertising is allowed. There are particular concerns for people with serious mental illness, given that about one third of all tobacco consumption is by people with current mental health problems. I could go into some of the complications of smoking and the relationship between nicotine and some of the psychotropic medications that are used, I would just quote, though, from the Royal College of Psychiatrists that says that e-cigarettes seem to be fairly effective in helping smokers to stop or control their smoking. But they go on to say that although they seem to be safe, we are not yet clear about longer-term health risks. My Lords, any benefits or disadvantages to public health are not yet well established, and this reflects concerns over their effectiveness as a smoking cessation aid, the variability of the components of e-cigarette vapour, and the absence of a significant health benefit associated with the dual use of e-cigarettes and tobacco cigarettes. The BMA strongly believes that a regulatory framework is essential, I do hope that noble lords will agree with the medical experts that have supported these regulations.
My lords, I think this has been a very interesting debate so far, and it has been good-humoured and full of humour as well. I was very glad to hear the noble lord, Lord Campbell-Savers, and the noble lady, Lady Hollins, talking about the seriousness of this situation. I and at least two other people I see in the chamber at the moment fought like tigers to make sure that we should get smoking banned in public places. Why did we do it? Because all the evidence suggested that it was a terrible scourge on people who were addicted to tobacco and addicted to smoking, that they just could not break the link. And from a personal point of view, I come from a family of five, of whom four died prematurely from either smoking or the effects of tobacco. So I know it, and I know friends who've died, and it hasn't been a very pleasant death either. Now, I'm not saying that vaping is going to cause that problem, but why do we need it? They say, okay, it's part of a smoking cessation thing. I really don't believe it. I think they should be banned totally and more money put into all this help for smoking cessation programs. They've worked, and why not carry on with the things that work? I shouldn't say this, but I'm going to say it. Nobody knows just how manipulative the tobacco industry was during the period when we were fighting. It was quite disgraceful. And I see my friend, Noble, well, my fellow in arms, said, looking at Lord Faulkner, looking at me too, and agreeing. And I am just so concerned that having gone through all of this and now dropping the smoking cessation, or at least reducing the money spent on the smoking cessation programs, that we will find ourselves, well, I won't be around, but in another 20 or 30 years, it'll all be doing again and people will be smoking. So I just say, please take care.
The Noble Baroness for referring to me and the part that a number of us played in making the United Kingdom a leader in attempting to reduce the prevalence of tobacco smoking. It was, as your lordships recall, this House which passed the amendments to the Children and Families Bill, which led to the UK being the first country in Europe to introduce standard packaging. In 2014. It is incidentally my understanding that if the regulations being debated today were annulled, then that legislation on standard packaging would be badly damaged. I'd be grateful if the Minister would comment on that when he replies. As the Noble Baroness Lady Walmsley said, these regulations are an important part of the way in which the United Kingdom should meet its obligations to the International Tobacco Treaty. And one of the requirements of that treaty is that we must take continuing action to cut smoking prevalence through comprehensive tobacco control strategies. These regulations also include other important measures, such as the prohibition of flavours in cigarettes, including menthol, which are designed to attract young people to start to smoke. There are new reporting obligations on the tobacco industry and rules on notifying new tobacco products. These provisions are important, my lords, and should not be lost by some attempt to make the climate easier for vaping. On electronic cigarettes, the subject of today's amendments, ASH estimates that they're used by around 2.8 million adults in Great Britain, and that the users are made up almost entirely of current and ex-smokers. Vapers report using these products to help them cut down or to quit altogether. But we must understand that electronic cigarettes are not a magic bullet. There are still 9 million smokers in our country, and our policies need to be broader than just encouraging smokers to switch to vaping. Oh, yeah. E-cigarettes do help people trying to stop, but only when these measures are supported by stop smoking services, which my noble friend Lord Hunt of King's Heath referred to, and the regrettable cut in the budgets for those services. We've heard from the noble Baroness Lady Hollins about the Royal College of Physicians, and the fact that their report says that electronic cigarettes are less harmful than smoking, but the health effects of long-term use are not yet known. And given the absence of long-term evidence and the addictiveness of nicotine, it is right and I think absolutely necessary that the regulations should strike a cautionary note. It would be helpful if the government could develop a review process which monitors the developing evidence on electronic cigarettes, publishes interim conclusions, and ensures that public health organisations and users are fully consulted. The House needs to be aware of the role of the tobacco industry in the nicotine and electronic cigarette market. Lady O'Cahane referred to the activities of the tobacco industry during the passage of the various pieces of legislation through Parliament. Their involvement includes the growing of the tobacco from which the nicotine is extracted. It includes the buying up of small independent electronic cigarette manufacturers, as well as the manufacture of new products. Investments in e-cigarettes by the tobacco industry also offer opportunities for them to claim legitimacy and get a foot in the door to re-engaging with policymakers. I cannot believe that anybody would like to see that happen.
I wonder if the noble lord would allow me to intervene on this point. Surely the tobacco industry looked around the world and saw help. This is like Kodak looking at digital photography coming along. Here was a huge threat to them. So of course they're now trying to muscle in on the act, but that's a good thing. If they start making electronic cigarettes and they become more profitable, they'll give up other cigarettes. The reason they got into this industry was because they saw it as a threat to them.
Yes, I'd be a little more convinced, my lords, if the tobacco industry took its responsibilities seriously in countries where there are not the same restrictions on smoking as there are in the Western democracies. The attempt to promote and advertise and sponsor tobacco smoking, particularly in the Far East, is utterly deplorable. And I'm afraid they view the whole of the tobacco and vaping market in a very, very cynical way. So I'm afraid I don't agree with the noble Viscount.
Sorry, more time. In South America, vaping is banned altogether. Why? Because the tobacco industry is very big and powerful in that part of the world.
Well, it's very interesting because the tobacco industry in countries, as I say, which take tobacco cessation seriously, are switching to vaping because they know that their own traditional market is largely lost. I mean, only last month in this country, they attempted to undermine public health by trying to overturn the standardised packaging regulations. They cannot be trusted, my lords. Finally, I share my noble friend Lord Hunt's call for continued funding for stop smoking services, making them accessible and available to all smokers, and for such services to work with electronic cigarettes. And it's wrong that these are being cut back at the same time as the regulations are being introduced. Our aim, my lords, must be to be as ambitious as the most committed nations are in achieving a tobacco-free society over the next few decades. Over the last 10 years, we have already come a huge distance in changing public attitudes towards smoking, which is now largely seen as socially unacceptable behaviour. My concern over vaping is that it must not in any way re-normalise the smoking habit.
My lord, if I may very briefly contribute to this debate. From my point of view, I do want to say to my noble friend, Lord Callanan, he
He chose very selectively, I think, to talk about the record of the Conservative Party and the coalition government in relation to tobacco control. I think he should just bear in mind that Conservatives, myself, my noble friend Lord Young of Cookham, in another place, from the opposition benches, also worked hard and succeeded in securing the ban on smoking in public places. And when we came into coalition government together, we implemented the ban on vending machines, sale through vending machines. We implemented a progressive display ban in shops, and I initiated the consultation on standardised packaging following discussions with Nicola Roxon, who was then the health minister in Australia, which my successors have taken forward. And the product of all that was that not only have we secured continuing reductions in the overall prevalence of smoking, albeit I could wish that that had been faster, but we secured, I think 3 years ago, recognition that we had amongst the toughest tobacco control regimes anywhere in the world. That is, I think, right, and we should strive to make that the case. I would say to colleagues this evening, were we, I know it's not going to be the effect of the motion, but were it the effect of the motion, and certainly indicatively, the motion in the name of my noble friend Lord Callan, were it to be passed, would indicate that it was your Lordship's desire, if they could, to withdraw these regulations, would be an entirely retrograde step in that respect. I won't go through all the ways in which the Tobacco Products Directive, in other respects than in relation to e-cigarettes, helps to strengthen the tobacco control regime, but it certainly does. I just isolate, I think, one important point which has not yet been mentioned. Much of what we have done in recent years, and certainly from my point of view, and I know of my colleagues, Anne Milton when she was Public Health Minister, and I believe it was Anna Soubry's and Jane Ellison's objectives subsequently, to seek to focus on reducing the initiation of smoking amongst young people. And we have some 200,000 young people a year who are initiating smoking. That's what we really have to bring down. We want to arrive at the point where there is absolutely minimised that initiation of smoking. As part of that, we do have to look, frankly, critically at how electronic cigarettes and vaping can contribute to the reduction of smoking through smoking cessation services, through access to that, and that's absolutely right that we should. And I don't have any brief against e-cigarettes in that respect. But we do have to pick up the point that was made by the noble Lord Faulkner of Worcester just in his final moments. We have to understand what the social and behavioural impacts of large numbers of people continuing to smoke e-cigarettes in the long term looks like. And I'm not sure that promoting it through advertising is necessarily the right way to go. Enabling smokers to access e-cigarettes and vaping and doing everything we can through the public health budget, and on another day and when more time allows, noble lords will know that it was my objective in creating a separate public health budget with local authorities was to maximise and protect our preventative activity, not to see it subsequently reduced. And I deplore that fact, because we were making considerable progress on smoking cessation services, and we should do. But we do have to think very hard, in addition to using e-cigarettes in that way, in a way which reduces smoking, that we don't create a new mechanism which might entrench in young people an expectation that they initiate any kind of smoking, be it vaping or e-cigarettes, or even worse, smoking tobacco cigarettes. So for that reason, I entirely agree with many other speakers that it would be undesirable to support my noble friend's motion, and I hope that the Minister will agree that we should reject it this evening.
My Lords, the noble Lord Lansley, in my view, is to be greatly personally congratulated for his tremendous record of achievement in this area, and his advice to be followed very carefully this evening, I think. I must declare, of course, my own interest as a former director of the organisation Action on Smoking and Health. There is, I think, listening to this debate, a consensus at least that using e-cigarettes is much safer than smoking.
together with other clean nicotine products, I believe that they have a very important role in cutting tobacco consumption and improving public health. But I don't agree with the e-cigarette trade body brief that has been circulated. This claimed that nicotine is not itself dangerous. As Baroness Hollins effectively pointed out, we have to recognise that it is a known toxin, it is poisonous when swallowed, and it is also addictive. I don't want to see e-cigarettes subject to more regulation than necessary, but I do want to see them subject to all the appropriate regulation necessary to support public health objectives. We know that the best chance of success for people seeking to quit smoking is to use smoking cessation services, as well as alternative nicotine products, in order to help reduce the withdrawal symptoms. So it seems to me, my lords, that the regulatory regime required for e-cigarettes and related products must be one that supports their use by smokers trying to quit. And I think that it's also right to discourage their use by children and young people who have never smoked. And both these objectives are supported by the regulations being introduced. I agree with the many noble lords this evening saying that we need a public information campaign to reassure smokers that electronic cigarettes are less harmful than normal smoking. But as the noble lord, Lord Hunt's amendment points out, there have been major cuts in media campaigns to persuade smokers to quit. And that, I think, is very regrettable, because such campaigns can be highly cost-effective in supporting quitting. We know that alternative nicotine products for smokers have most public benefit when they're used together with expert behavioural support. That's one reason why I think we need to make sure that such products can be available on prescription for people seeking help in quitting tobacco products. Our approach to e-cigarettes, therefore, must be to treat them not as an exciting new social drug, nor as a cash cow for e-cigarette companies, many of which are owned by the tobacco industry, but as a potentially important means of improving public health and reducing the toll of death and disease caused by smoking. The regulations under discussion are not perfect, but they do include important steps in tobacco control that must not be lost and must be part of a tobacco control strategy that must be properly resourced to produce real public health dividends.
My lords, I find these regulations bizarre as far as the vaping goes. They defy both logic and the evidence. My lords, Brussels believe that vaping could provide a gateway to smoking and that these tough new laws are necessary to protect non-smokers, particularly children, from using e-cigarettes. But, my lords, the evidence does not support this. The Office of National Statistics has said, I quote, e-cigarettes are almost exclusively used by smokers and ex-smokers, and almost none of those who have never smoked cigarettes were e-cigarette users. Also, Cancer Research UK found that smokers who vape are 60% more likely to quit than those that use Willpower or over-the-counter nicotine products. Their statistics demonstrate that vaping is used almost entirely, 99%, by current and ex-smokers. Over 60% of them say that the sole reason for vaping is to stop using traditional tobacco. Interestingly, only 0.2% of under 18-year-old non-smokers have tried vaping, although continued use is negligible. So, my lords, the evidence does not support Brussels' reasons for this regulation. Public Health England has said that, I quote, there is a need to publicise the current best estimate that using e-cigarettes is 95% safer than smoking, close quotes. And Professor John Britton of the Royal College of Physicians says, I quote, if all smokers in Britain stopped smoking cigarettes and started vaping, we would save 5 million deaths in people who are alive today. It's a massive potential public health prize. Close quotes. My lords, you would think that Brussels would want to encourage vaping, but no, no, that would be too logical. Brussels is banning advertising of e-cigarettes, but this is cack-handed for two reasons. If we can advertise nicotine patches, why not e-cigarettes, which is just another way of absorbing nicotine into the body? And as the noble Baroness Lady Hollins said, advertising can be done on buses, I didn't know that, so why can't it be done in newspapers and televisions, etc.? And secondly, as e-cigarettes are 95% less harmful than tobacco, how are tobacco smokers to find out about vaping and thus improve their health by giving up tobacco? My lords, Brussels wants e-cigarettes to carry a health warning. But my lords, what on earth will these health warnings say? May I suggest, if you smoke tobacco, try vaping, as it is 95% less risky than tobacco. But I don't think that's what Brussels have in mind. These regulations will also restrict the nicotine strength of e-cigarettes to 2%. It is this that really irritates me. I started smoking before I was a teenager, building up to 50 cigarettes a day. I tried every trick in the book to kick the habit, but nothing seems to work. Rather like the noble Lord Campbell Savers. I knew that it would kill me, that I'd be gathered by the Grim Reaper before time, but I just could not stop. I could not kick the habit. Then two summers ago, a taxi driver suggested that I tried e-cigarettes. It worked for him, but he insisted that I must use the strongest nicotine strength available, because if I did not, I would not get the necessary nicotine hit, and I'd be back on fags in no time. I took his advice about using the strongest nicotine, 2.4%, and I've not looked back. I've not had a puff of tobacco since two summers ago. So, my lords, they do work, and they do help people to stop smoking. My lords, I still use the 2.4% strength, and I find that vaping gives me about 75 to 80% of the satisfaction that tobacco smoking did. But I can live with that. What worries me is that when I run out of my supply of 2.4% nicotine and have to reduce to 2% as per this regulation, I will not get the necessary nicotine hit and I might return to tobacco. There are currently hundreds of thousands of vapers like me that use nicotine strengths above 2%, and like me, they rely on that higher strength nicotine to prevent them from returning to tobacco. Also, the higher nicotine strengths are critically important in helping smokers with the initial transaction from tobacco to vaping. By imposing a limit of 2%, many vapers may return to using tobacco or buying stronger nicotine illegally on the black market. So, my lords, these regulations directly affect me, my health and my well-being. I couldn't understand why Brussels wanted to penalise the vaping industry and the vaping users, but after hearing from my noble friend Lord Callanan's contribution on the pharmaceutical and tobacco industry having got at Brussels, all is now clear. I'm sorry that we only have a regret motion this evening. If I could vote against these regulations, I would.
My Lords, first of all, could I congratulate my noble friend Lord Callan on the very excellent case which he put. I don't proceed by repeating any of the arguments. But I have looked at these regulations, some people who've spoken in this debate clearly haven't. If you wanted to actually sabotage a product and add to the costs of producing that product and limit the scope for competition with that product and drive out of business small producers, it is hard to see how a more effective job could be done in respect of the regulations that apply to electronic cigarettes. And as far as the noble lords who argued that this was all a plot by the tobacco companies are concerned, one way of ensuring that all of this ends up in the hands of large businesses will be by pursuing exactly these regulations, by limiting choice, and of course by creating a black market which will be accessed through the internet, as we've seen occur over and over again in respect of medicinal products. There seems to be no logic in the regulations. We've already touched on the point as to why some advertising is allowed and not others. And I find it extraordinary that a government should want to ban advertising when the evidence which we've had from Ash, the noble lord referred to that, says that perceptions of harm from electronic cigarettes have grown, with only 15% of the public accurately believing in 2016 that electronic cigarettes are a lot less harmful than smoking. Now, if most people don't realise the benefits of it, what on earth is the logic of preventing people advertising it? And how does the noble lady, Baroness Walmsley, explain that she wants a public information campaign? How do you have a public information campaign without advertising the benefits of electronic cigarettes? And therefore, why is she against the advertising of electronic cigarettes? There is no logic in this. Now, I hope he doesn't mind me mentioning the fact, but my son is... I'll give way in a second, if I just make finish the point. My son is 37 years old. He has smoked cigarettes since he was 16, to the best of my knowledge, probably earlier. Three Christmases ago, and he, smoked very heavily. Three Christmases ago, I should declare an interest, I bought him an electronic cigarette. And as a result, he's reduced the levels of nicotine, and all the things that we've tried, I've tried blackmail, I've tried bullying, and we've tried nicotine patches, we've tried everything under the sun, and it's worked. And the figures show that a third of the 2.8 million adults who are vaping in this country are ex-smokers. So the arguments that have been put for the public health benefits are overwhelming. Now, it pains me to say this, but this is a classic example of gold plating of European regulations by the UK Health Department. It is. Yeah. And of course, the point is that because they've gold plated these regulations, there's actually nothing we can do about it because they're EU regulations, and we're required to implement them. And I just wonder what on earth was going on in the Department of Health that made them do this. And when you see something absurd happening, ask qui bono, who benefits from this? Well, certainly the government benefits from it, because people who are continuing to smoke cigarettes will pay a very considerable amount in tax to the exchequer. Those people who start vaping, instead of paying, I don't know how much, I've never smoked in my life, don't know how much a packet of cigarettes costs, but I'm told it's about £9. £9 for 20 cigarettes. Vaping, you won't spend that in a week. And therefore, for those families on low incomes, and many of the people who smoke heavily are amongst the lowest income families, will actually benefit from something which enables them to deal with the addiction which they have to nicotine and be able to remove from it. So who benefits from this? Certainly not those people who are amongst the poorest in our country who are smokers. The Exchequer benefits, the Treasury benefits, if people are still smoking cigarettes because they get the tax on those cigarettes, which is very considerable. And of course, the pharmaceutical companies benefit, who sell the nicotine patches. And of course, the tobacco companies benefit, because people are not switching away. So what on earth is the government doing promoting the interests of the tobacco companies and the large pharmaceuticals? Because that is the effect of this. And the regulations go, I mean, the detail is unbelievable. It even spells out which typeface, Helvetica, whether it should be bold or italic, should appear on the warnings. I mean, this is North Korean stuff. This is utterly absurd regulation. And we may laugh of it, but what it means, as the noble Lord Campbell Savers pointed out, what it means is that small businesses up and down the country will have to comply with these regulations, will have to work out what they mean, will have to change all their literature and everything else, and as a result be driven out of business. Now, we're in a bit of a quandary here because, of course, there's much in these regulations which is actually quite desirable. And when we have left the European Union, we will be in a position where we can actually hold our ministers to account and actually hold votes and actually make these things happen. But I hadn't realised this very clever operation by the Department of Health. What you do is you have some absurd regulations which you know you're not going to get through the House of Commons. So what you do is you go to Brussels and you persuade them to include them in an EU directive, and then hey-ho, they have to sail through both houses because there's nothing we can do about it. And we all take part in this pantomime where we explain all the reasons why they should be changed, knowing full well there's very little we can do about it until we leave the European Union. So I congratulate my noble friend on his efforts, and I do hope that the government will rethink, when they are free to do so, these absurd regulations, which will undoubtedly cost lives. They will undoubtedly cost lives. And they are a classic example of how big business is able to use Brussels, together with lobbying organisations, to the disadvantage, and indeed in this case, to the life-threatening disadvantage of the citizens of this country.
Bring the House. Lord Forsyth said. He suggested there was an inconsistency in my remarks. Can I point out to him that my regret motion regrets the advertising ban, and if there were no advertising ban, it would be perfectly possible to have a public information campaign.
Yeah. My Lords, can I bring the House back after the noble Lord Forsyth's excursion into Europe bashing? To the subject in hand, which is these regulations. And can I say that I think the noble Lord Rennard hit the nail on the head. Why are the major tobacco companies all piling into these products and their manufacture and distribution and promotion globally? And it's not because they, out of the spirit of public protection, want to see smokers take up these products rather than the main part of their activities, which will continue to be the pushing of tobacco globally. And so we've got to ask ourselves why there is a need for regulation in this area. The reality is electronic cigarettes are effective in reducing, in the case of smokers, their reliance on tobacco. But it does need to be associated with a wider tobacco control strategy and some good targeted mass promotion, not of individual products in the vaping field, but with the concept that if you are a smoker, that vaping may be one of the things, amongst others, that can help you. And that must include psychological support as well as simply a change of product. And I would hope, too, that the government would ponder on further increases in the price of tobacco, which at the end of the day are the most effective ways of reducing demand. So perhaps we can hear from the Minister what the government is planning to ensure that there is public promotion of vaping as an alternative for smokers, access to good quality evidence-based stop smoking services and changes in costs, and not delude ourselves that the tobacco manufacturers are getting into vaping products simply to allow people who are smoking currently to reduce their risk. They're getting into it because that, in their view, is the double whammy, an alternative product which can run alongside their very damaging products, which will continue, and a little bit of what used to be called in the environment movement greenwashing, I don't know what you call it, in the public health movement, in order to make their image more acceptable publicly. So I would not support Lord Callan's amendment.
My Lords, I'm going to be extremely brief because we need to press on to what the government, what the Minister says. But I think it's very important to point out that this is smack in the tradition of harm reduction, which was pioneered in this country with needle exchanges for HIV addicts. And we didn't go around saying that's a bad policy because needles are dangerous things. We said let's look at the relative risks. And we now know that there is a motorway out of smoking by vaping. And on the other carriageway, there are no cars virtually at all, as we've heard the data from my noble friend Earl Cathcart. And one final, very quick suggestion, if we want to get public information out there, why don't we insist that cigarette packets, which already carry a warning label, carry a label which says, have you tried vaping instead? There is very good evidence that it's much safer. That would be factual, it would be targeted at smokers, it would be beneficial, it would save lives, and it would cost nothing.
Well, my Lords, I had feared before this debate started that this would be a bit like Groundhog Day in the Grand Committee room earlier. But actually, I have to say that it has been a very fascinating and excellent debate, and I would like to thank Lord Callan and Lord Hunt and Baroness Walmsley for tabling their various motions and amendments. I think it has been a very good debate. I should start off by saying that all my instincts are always against regulation, and that is where I start from. In my view, there's normally a presumption against regulation. And I should also make it absolutely clear that there is no doubt that vaping is far, far better for you than smoking. And if as a result of these regulations, we were to more people would carry on smoking, then we would indeed have shot ourselves in the foot. But just to use the analogy that my noble friend Viscount Ridley used about needle exchanges, the point is that they should be at least be clean needles. So I think I would agree with him in his argument, but I think we need some regulation to ensure that vaping is not abused, if I can put it that way. There are, I think, just a small number of important points that I would like to make, and these have been raised by noble lords in this debate. But firstly, we have fought long and hard, and members of this House have been at the forefront of that, to denormalise smoking behaviours. It is right to take a precautionary approach to managing any risk that e-cigarettes renormalises smoking behaviours, particularly by restricting children's exposure to marketing and imagery for e-cigarettes. Glamorising these products with adverts reminiscent of those from the tobacco industry many years ago can only make them more attractive to children. Recent research by the Cambridge Behavioural Research Unit also suggests that exposure to e-cigarette adverts influences children's perception of smoking tobacco. It reduces their belief in the harm of occasional smoking, and this has the potential to undermine some of the great progress we have made over the last six decades in controlling the smoking of tobacco. I know that there are calls for the return to self-regulation, but just last week we saw the Advertising Standards Authority rule that a glamorous advert, and I don't think props are allowed in this house, but this is a four-page advert on the front and the back of the Evening Standard. And on the front there is a very attractive young woman looking out over London smoking a cigarette. And on the back there is a sort of a James Bond lookalike jumping out of a helicopter. Now that is not aimed at people who are smoking. This is aimed at young people who are thinking about, who might then think about smoking. So let's not, I know figures have been put about that there is no evidence that young people are influenced by this kind of advertising. But that is not the case everywhere. In the US, they are seeing an upward trend of children that had never smoked cigarettes using e-cigarettes. And data from Poland shows that 30% of children surveyed use e-cigarettes. The government has therefore taken a precautionary approach to any possible risk of the renormalisation of smoking behaviours.
96% of smokers are already aware of e-cigarettes. So I'm pretty clear in my mind that promotion is not about raising consumer awareness. It is already 96% of that market. Whilst businesses' ability to communicate about their products may have been curtailed in the interest of protecting children, they have not been banned outright. The regulations will not prohibit information being provided to customers either online or in physical retail outlets, nor will it ban independent reviews of these products or discussion in e-forums. Some advertising will be allowed, such as point-of-sale billboards and leaflets, essentially the information routes that were used when e-cigarette sales and use were growing the fastest. Now, the point that my noble friend Lord Forsyth made about billboards and buses and the like, this has been designed. The reason for the distinction in the outlets is to try and minimise the impact on young people, and that is, I think, what lies behind the differentiation of the different advertising mediums. Second point I'd make is this: the regulations provide minimum product standards and reporting of ingredients and emissions. This should reassure smokers who are looking to quit that e-cigarettes are safe and high quality, and provide confidence to the government and health professionals like GPs in recommending them to smokers. The product standards and the regulations are a result of balancing user needs and risk of accidental exposure to children. Of the reported poisoning incidents, running at some 250 a year, a third of those relate to young children under the age of four. The regulations require child-resistant packaging, and the 20 mil per millilitre limit for nicotine, combined with the size restrictions on tanks, ensures a maximum exposure of 40 mg nicotine, which is below the level of 50 mg that the EU Chemical Agency assess that would cause acute toxic effects to toddlers. ASH recently published data indicating that only 9% of vapors report using an e-liquid containing more than 19 milligrams milliliter or before. I know that my noble friend Lord Cathcart is a heavy user of this particular substance, but he is amongst only 9%. Moreover, the changes in technology will increasingly make it possible for users to get high levels of nicotine uptake for any given strength. And of course, it is available. It is producers can get a higher strength approved by the MHRA. The third sort of main argument that I would use in favour of this of these regulations is that the UK's approach to the regulation of e-cigarettes has and will remain pragmatic and evidence-based. We have one of the most liberal approaches to e-cigarette regulation in the world. We have implemented domestic age of sale legislation, preventing sale to under 18s, but we have not banned flavours in e-liquids or cross-border distance sales, nor have we restricted vaping in public places. I would remind your lordships that the latter two measures have been introduced in around two-thirds of all other EU member states, and also common in other parts of the world. So I'm not sure that the noble Lord Forsyth is right when he talks about gold plating in this particular context.
I'm just contemplating his argument about children, which obviously one wants to avoid, being exposed to dangerous quantities of nicotine, and how there's a need, therefore, to reduce the packaging. Is he planning to do the same for other household products, domestic bleach, dishwasher liquid, things of that kind? I mean, surely we can't approach that kind of problem through regulation. Surely it's about encouraging parents to behave responsibly.
Well, of course, I mean, there are many products that do have tamper-proof packaging around them. I can't debate all the various products that he mentioned, but certainly it seems entirely reasonable to me that this particular product should be tamper-proof. I think if a child was to swallow nicotine in these kinds of volumes, it would have a very, very serious impact. So it seems to me to have tamper-proof packaging is entirely reasonable. The government has asked that the MHRA and local authorities and others involved in the enforcement of these regulations to develop a compliant regime together with the businesses who are currently in this industry, and will take a pragmatic approach to implementing the new notification system. Notification fees are low, £150 per product. I think it's £60 a year, annual year, as a top-up, and they are set only to recover costs. The MHRA have also developed guidance that minimises the burden on businesses. My Lords, e-cigarettes are not harmless. Nicotine is both toxic and addictive, and there are unanswered questions on the effects of longer-term use. It is far better to vape than it is to smoke, but it is far better to do neither. These regulations reduce the risk of harm to children and protect against the renormalisation of tobacco use. They provide assurance on relative safety for users, and they provide legal certainty for businesses who wish to sell these products across the EU. I would also underline that these regulations have the full support of the four nations of the UK, and they are fully supported by many of those in the health community who have been involved in tobacco reduction, including ASH, Cancer Research UK, and the British Medical Association. The Royal College of Physicians agrees in its report on, I quote, the need for regulation of e-cigarettes to protect the public, and states that although e-cigarettes are estimated to be of the order of 95% less harmful than smoked tobacco, they are not harmless. Moving forward, the government is committed to a full review of the functioning of these regulations, including...
Is there a danger that a black market will develop?
It is possible. There's always a possibility when there's regulation that a black market will develop. And for the very high-strength products, which had to be regulated by the MHRA, the ones above 20 milligrams, there is a risk that there will be a black market. But I think I recall from the Noble Lord's comments earlier, he indicated there was already a black market that had developed in this product. And I think that what we are trying to do is at least to bring some minimum quality standards into this market so that people who are thinking of moving from smoking to using e-cigarettes can have confidence in the product that they use is regulated to a minimum standard. I remind the Noble Lords that the new and important tobacco control measures that are also contained in these regulations, I haven't talked about them specifically because I think they're slightly off the main point of the debate today, but the regulation will be reviewed within 5 years of entering into force. And I can also commit here to commissioning Public Health England to update their evidence report on e-cigarettes annually until the end of this Parliament, and to include within its quit smoking campaigns messaging about the safety of e-cigarettes. I think there are clearly strong arguments on both sides of this debate, but I do feel that, and as I said, I am not an instinctive regulator by any means, that this regulation is proportionate. I don't think it goes over the top. I think it's entirely sensible. It is backed by the RCP and all the major charities in this field, in this area, and I hope that my noble friend, Lord Callaghan, will not wish to push this to a vote, but it's, of course, entirely his decision.
My Lords, can I thank the Noble Lord, Lord Pryor, for his wind-up, which I think was very fair. And I agree with him that this has been a good debate, an excellent debate, and we've seen various views put forward. And I do, my Lords, understand why some Noble Lords have concerns about e-cigarettes. I understand the issue in relation to young people in particular. I understand that there is still some uncertainties. And, my Lords, I do accept that there is a need for some regulation in relation to e-cigarettes. But I'd also say and I thought the Royal College of Physicians actually did produce an excellent and dispassionate report. But in the end, they did conclude that whilst not absolutely safe, the hazard health arising from long-term vapour inhalation from the electronic cigarettes available today is unlikely to exceed 5% of the harm from smoking tobacco. That, for me, my Lords, is a pretty powerful statistic. They do support the regulations, I understand that,
We've been told, Baroness O'Cohane, 2.8 million people currently use e-cigarettes. We know that often it's the poorest people in society for whom many of the traditional approaches to giving up smoking have not touched. Equally, my lords, we also know that there is a problem about smokers who think that e-cigarettes may be much more harmful than they actually are. The noble Lord Lord Prior said, rightfully, smokers are aware of e-cigarettes. I take that point. But it is this worrying statistic that many smokers feel that e-cigarettes are really very harmful, almost as harmful as smoking cigarettes at all, which worries me, and I do worry that the regulations may make that worse. And this is where the absence of cohesive, strongly financed public health programmes comes in, which is why, my lords, I believe that my motion finds a delicate way through the morass that we've been debating today, and why I wish to test the opinion of the House.
The question is that the amendment in the name of Lord Hunt of King's Heath be agreed to. As many as of that opinion will say content.
Content.
The contrary, not content.
Not content.
Clear the bar.
I didn't have the proper microphones on. Yes, we've got volume. Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. Sav, would you want to go through that one again?
Yeah, I'm just saying the positives and the people that were for it were very, very passionate and really, really good. But the negatives were very much straight from the School of Ash, straight from Ash's mouth.
Yes, absolutely right. I think, I hope, yes, volume should be getting through now. Marco, your thoughts?
Yes, as we've said, it's very much the Ash party line, and I wonder who wrote most of the scripts that the againsters were reading most carefully there. There were some little moments. I can't remember what the lady's name was, but she stopped, gathered her thoughts, and then carried on because she realised she was lying through her teeth. And the same old arguments. It's the children. It's, you know, the plain packaging. I loved the bit. It says, why not put, have you tried vaping on a packet of fags? I thought that was brilliant. Absolutely classic.
It's a damn good idea. Folks are a little bit confused in chat as to what's happening. What's happening is they're now voting on the amendment. That'll go out, and then Lord Callanan's whole motion will go forward. So either the amendment gets passed and goes into the motion, at which point I think they probably start talking again, and then Callanan will wind up and say what's going on, and then Pryor will come back, I have no doubt. Matt, we missed your bit altogether. What do you reckon to what's been going on?
Well, it's been echoed by now by Sav and Marco, but it's very much a mixed bag, isn't it? We got those that really want to see the CPD amended and changed, and we got those who think it's a brilliant thing, and, they're frankly in the pay of someone.
It certainly looks that way, doesn't it? I'm just keeping an eyeball on what's going on, so I'll switch to the shot where we've got the Lord's Commission, the Lord's stuff going on. I shall mute those buggers because we don't need to hear them, but we'll see them come back in, and when we do see them come back in, we'll switch back to them and find out what's going on. Oh, hang on.
Amendment in the name of Lord Hunt of King's Heath be agreed to. As many as of that opinion will say content.
Content.
Contrary, not content.
Not content.
The contents will go to the right by the throne, the not contents to the left by the bar.
So we're actually getting a vote, is what's happening. There is actually going to be a vote on Lord Hunt's amendment, so that's what they're off to do. To the right of the throne and the left of the throne. I'm not entirely certain how it all works in the Lords, because I've never seen a vote in there before. But they will come back in a bit and tell us, I think. Sav, having listened to all of this debate, I mean, we've heard a whole load of folks on the opposite side to us come up with what they consider to be evidence. What do you make of that?
Some of the evidence that we're hearing being quoted was stuff that has been, I mean, first of all, other countries, that has been debunked long, long ago, and all the relevant stuff that is out there now just didn't seem to get a mention. So a lot of it is obviously being fed to them from somewhere. You could tell there were so many on the negative side that were very, very uncomfortable with what they were reading. They weren't sure of the facts, and you think, you're not even putting the effort in yourself. There were so many letters sent, and you think, where are you getting this stuff from? It's sad. It really is sad to see that.
In fact, I believe a few letters were actually read out.
Yeah.
Which was some of the rules there, you know, which is great to see. It's super. It's clear that, you know, our
correspondence
is getting to
it. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes, I'll come up in mirrored format to say this so people can see me ugly mug. Don't anybody ever think that the letter writing campaign that we undertook was a waste of time. It was far from it. As you've heard, we have had an effect. And I have seen people who were quite against, from what I've heard them say before, who were now much more on the fence. Who the hell was it? Had the fence post shoved right up her arse.
Was that Baroness Hollins or?
Yeah, the first lady coming out.
Walmsley. Yes.
I've got a list of
that. Walmsley, isn't it?
I think so. I've got a list that I'll drop in the chat later of all the sort of on the fence or negatives that we could gather between us, and so I'll drop that in to chat so everyone's got an idea of who's who.
Yes, indeed. I'm keeping an eye on what's going on, and you can see they're just moseying about, not doing much, stood having a natter and what have you. I mean, somebody did say earlier on in chat, and I've got to mention this, and they're right as well. Can you see the Commons sitting and doing this at this time of night? Because I'm buggered if I can.
Oh, no.
The question is, the big question is, of course, when they go out to vote, does somebody hold the door? Hold the door. Hold the door. Hold door. Hold door. Hold door. Hold door. Does somebody do that? Just lost half the audience there, haven't we?
Yeah.
If you don't watch Game of Thrones, you've got no idea. Dick Puddlecourt has said Lord Rennard is an ash stooge. He's not wrong. He's not wrong.
So many ash stooges in that house tonight.
Yes, never underestimate the power of a disingenuous lying fuckwit. That's what I say.
Right, let's not forget it was Ash that turned this from a fatal to a regret.
Yes.
Yes. And I would really like to see some Freedom of Information Act requests on stocks and shares held by those people.
It's all in their, it should all be in their declarations of whatever it is that's held on the website. The Freedom of Information requests I would like to see would be the ones where Deborah Arnott has contacted these people individually. And you can get that from the Houses of Parliament. So there's a task for people, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes. Hang on. They're all sitting down again. What's happening? What's happening? What's happening? Let's have a quick look and see if we can see. You're on screen, Marco. Don't pick your nose. well, you can if you want, but hide it under a blanket. It's all gone very quiet in there.
It has. I'm watching it as well, but I'm a few seconds behind the stream that we're putting out, so I didn't know.
Did you not hear? Right, well, no. They all seem to be taking their seats again, so I assume that they've gone through the Lord's lobbies, and I'm expecting...
Is that a tea trolley or a mobility scooter? Oh, it's a mobility scooter.
Just careful now. Come on. We could be in one of those one of these days. Well, I've already got one.
It would be a free wheel, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Here we are.
Thanks. Heath, be agreed to.
The wifey with the papers coming down now. Is she?
I don't know, I can't hear anything.
All gone quiet over there. I think they're waiting for the tellers to come in. Pen's been barred. She stood up again. No, she's still sitting on the wool sack. Is that
you
a teller?
Get our captain's done, we've got a mic stand on.
See that again, Matt?
I said, do you think you can get our chap to tell them they haven't got their mics turned on?
Well, they tell us.
Why?
That was my fault. I never said I was professional. I mean, I was, but I never said I was. Oh, somebody's come in with a piece of paper. Two fellas in suits. Here we go. Do we? Yes, the back on. Oh, I forgot, they've got to count it again. Read the signatures. Check for the Lord Privy Seal's seal, or his privy, one or the other. Right, they're stood there now. With fishing rod.
My lords, there have voted contents 57, not contents 91, so the not contents have it.
So that's the not contents for the amendment, I think. Now I think it goes to the full motion.
The question is that the original motion be agreed to. As many...
Thank you. Can I first of all thank all those noble lords who've contributed to the debate this evening? It's been a fascinating and instructive debate, and if nothing else, it's giving me the opportunity to go into the content lobby for the first time in my parliamentary career in this House so far. I'm normally quite a loyal government backbencher. It has been an interesting debate. I have to say I don't agree with many of the conclusions given by the Minister that these regulations are proportionate and not over the top. I think they're totally disproportionate and totally over the top. Let me first of all clear up a couple of confusions that have arisen. Firstly, I have no problem with the vast majority of these regulations. All of the regulations relating to regulation of normal tobacco products I completely support. It's only the sections on e-cigarette which I think were wrong. I mean, the clue is in the name. E-cigarettes are not tobacco products. They should not be in this directive in the first place, and I argued this when it was originally proposed in Brussels. But of course, given the nature of regulations, it was not possible to amend it just to take out the electronic cigarette part of it without regretting the whole thing. So I, in response to those people that have made the points about the main parts of the regulation, I agree, I support them, and as far as I know, all of my colleagues who supported me also support those bits of the regulation. The second is a number of arguments have been made about the big tobacco companies. I'm entirely convinced that the big tobacco companies would support these regulations as they are, for the simple reason that at the moment the e-cigarette vaping market is dominated by small and medium-sized enterprises. The costs of regulation that are going to be imposed by this directive are considerable. The big pharmaceutical companies and the big tobacco companies will be able to bear the costs of that regulation. They will buy up, as they are indeed starting to do, a lot of the little companies, and they will be able to bear the costs of regulation. It was a great revelation to me when I first arrived in the European Parliament. I had naively assumed that business would be opposed to a regulation, but actually most big business think regulation is a great thing, as was once described to me by the chairman of a big pharmaceutical company, because it enables them to get rid of what he calls free riders. In other words, the small companies that were taking his market share, and but of course did not have big corporate compliance departments, did not have big lobbying and PR operations. So I'm entirely convinced that actually approving these regulations is to the benefit of big pharmaceutical and big tobacco companies. But however, given all of that, and given the indications from many members of this House that they will in fact not support the remainder of my motion, I would like to beg to withdraw the motion. Thank you.
Is it your Lordship's pleasure that this motion be withdrawn? The motion is by leave withdrawn. Motion, Baroness Walmsley.
My Lords, the buses are running very late this evening, and I have made my views about these regulations very clear. And since this is a non-fatal regret motion on a non-fatal regret motion, I see no reason to waste the time of the House by voting upon it. So I beg leave to withdraw my motion.
The question is that... I beg your pardon. Is it your Lordship's pleasure that this motion be withdrawn? The motion is by leave withdrawn.
My Lords, I beg to move that the House be once again in committee on the Buses Bill.
The question is that the House do now again resolve itself into a committee upon the Bill.
Right, we're back in my studio now. Look at that, seamless. Okay, so what did we just say? See there? Because I was literally just messing around with stuff.
What we saw was an incredible demonstration of how politics in the UK works. And I've got to be honest, I'm not wholly convinced that it does work all that well when you've got a situation that somebody puts up... a motion like this. I think the whole idea is to let the government, the MHRA, the Department of Health, and various other people discover what the hell is actually going on with e-cigs in this country. And I've got to be honest, I'm very pleased that they've done that. It's just a great shame that it wasn't still the fatal motion.
Absolutely, yeah. It's been quite an enlightening watch, to be honest. I think I've learnt a fair bit of how things happen tonight. Marco, you got any thoughts?
Yeah, well, if you saw the, I can't remember what her name was, Sav probably has her name, but the Lib Dem lady, she was basically saying, we don't think we should waste any time on this. We're not going to vote for you. So basically, stand down or you're going to get pushed over. That's basically what happened just there. He had no other option but to withdraw the motion because he was going to get no support because Ash had been and whispered in ears, basically.
Yes.
Allegedly,
yes.
If nothing else, though, it has achieved a debate, which is something. It's not.
Yeah, and we mustn't forget that all those letters that were written, you know, some were read out in that debate. And they have those letters, they have that information. The problem with that we're still seeing is that the wrong people are giving the right people the wrong information. Mm-hmm. And they're acting upon it because they believe it to be true. Where they won't believe people like us, because we're just people, but they'll believe people like Ash, people like Chapman, because they're apparently professionals. Allegedly.
Allegedly, indeed. Yeah.
Allegedly, yeah. Right. Yeah. I think, look, I find myself being quite heartened, I've got to be honest. As Judy G has just said, the Lords are patently one of the only few legislative bodies, if you like, that's actually bloody listened and actually done something about it. Let's face it, Soubry misled the House of Commons, and the House of Commons traditionally doesn't seem to do much in the way of oversight of anything that happens to EU legislation. In fact, the majority of the time, they're misinformed anyway. But we have a situation now where the word is in Hansard, and it's there for everybody to listen to. Yes, there's been all of the idiocy that is anti-ESIG, if you like, or anti our particular position. But what it has pointed out is the arguments that they want to use politically against e-cigs. We now know what they are. We now know what we've got to write to our representatives about. We now know what evidence we need to get hold of to be able to put this in front of people who legislate within the UK and get them to get it right. One of the things that came out of all of this, it seems to me, was that once the whole exit from the EU is complete, we can actually get shot of this shite. So it's shite, get shot. It's not going to happen today, but it can happen further down the road. And if that's the case, that gives me some optimism. The fact that, yet again, Martin Callanan has started this crusade, if you like, and has picked up supporters along the way, voluble supporters. You've just got to listen to Cathcart and Forsyth, at the least. And Lawson wasn't there, and there were one or two others that weren't there, but they're very voluble on this as well. We've gained, I think, a lot of support in high places. And that, again, gives me cause for optimism. I do think that those of us that are going to be down at the PHE event on Wednesday have got an awful lot of work to do. We've got an awful lot of people to talk to, but I know we can bring more support to the table there. I'm going to be having a few words with people from the RCP and from various other places, including Cancer Research UK, to try and get them to change their tune and to support Martin Callanan's view. I think it's very important that we do that. I think we as vapers need to do that. We need to be in touch with our representatives, whether they're, you know, MSPs, AMs, MPs, it doesn't matter what they are. We need to be in touch with them, and we need to support what Lord Callanan was saying. 6, 7, 8, gone. That's where we need to be. Sorry.
No, you're totally right there, Dave. That's really what we need is 6, 7, 8 gone. And it's a shame that they didn't support the amendment, which was to take 6, 7, and 8 out of the TPD. And it's a shame that Callan was forced into a fatal, against the fatal motion that he first put up, because of all the viciousness from the naysayers who got to the right people.
Yes. I think, and again, Laurie and Jolly Carulian say in chat has brought this up, and it's right. We've got to get our MPs, AMs, MSPs, we've got to get everybody to understand plain packaging is not affected by this. Smoking in cars under 18, not affected by this. None of that is part of the TPD. None of it. So make sure, we've got to make sure that our representatives are aware of that, that they're not taking in by the shite that Ash is putting out. That's got to be absolutely seen to. We've got to be sure that that is seen to. If we don't, We're filling every potential vapor out there. We've got a campaign. We've got a campaign hard. We've got a campaign loud. We've got to force government to do the right thing. It's not going to happen soon. It's not going to happen easily. There's, as Keith would call it, a constitutional crisis now. This is going to give us a little bit of time to gather our ammunition, to muster the forces, to get the ranks together so that we're all singing off the same page, so that we're all doing the same thing at the same time to the right people. And if we do that, if we make a loud noise, if we speak with one voice, we might be successful. Again, I'll shut up, I'm sorry.
It's pretty clear that vaping has not been defeated yet. I mean, it keeps on going on. Yes, we got the TPD in effect now as we speak. We've got off lightly compared to the rest of Europe and whatever. We know that. And I think there is leg room still for us to keep campaigning. And, you know, if we give up now, that's it. We're done. But if we keep on plugging away at it, we're going to get somewhere. It's as simple as that. I see Marco's agreeing there by having a good vape.
Yeah. I'm celebrating the vape. That's what I'm doing. We can't just give up. We're going to continue fighting the good fight. We've still got another, what have we got, 10 months before the TPD is going to be fully implemented. So May 2017. We'll just have to keep going, keep fighting and keep speaking to the representatives. Obviously, the next few months is quite volatile politically with everything that's going on currently. But, you know, there's little point now talking to MEPs. So we may as well target our MPs and our Lords and directly at government ministers. That's what we need.
Yeah, and as we've seen tonight, that talking to our Lords and our MPs does have an effect.
Yes.
Hey, sorry.
Distant Scouse has said that this is all good stuff, but we're only preaching to the converted. Then this is what you need to do. Share this everywhere. Get everybody to watch the stuff that we do on campaigning. And I'm not talking about just on VTTV. I'm talking about everything that is on YouTube. Get people to watch it. Get everybody to watch it. Get everybody that you know to understand where we are and why we're where we are, why we're here, why we're campaigning. Take the word out there. Sav will attest, for years I've avoided the evangelical voice, but I think now we need to be evangelical. We need to get out there and get people to understand why we are where we are and why we need to change where we are. And the best way of doing that is to point people at the YouTube videos, at the various different blogs. Go and have a look at Dick Puddlecourt. Go and read Cerulean C's blog. Go and have a look at all of these blogs. There's Vaping Point as well. All the YouTube channels. And I don't exclude any of the vaping channels from that. Get people to go and watch people who advocate. Get them to understand. Spread it out there. Become the virus for vaping. Get it viral. If we do that, we could stand a chance. We've got to do it. If we don't, we lose. We give up, we lose. If we don't take action, we lose. We've got to act.
Well said. Shall we, do you think we should wrap up now, since we've been on the air for, what, nearly 3 hours?
2.5 hours have been on here. Yeah. Yes.
I think so. Yeah. As Brian Coase said, look up all the GFN videos, everything. Whatever you think is worthwhile for people to watch, spread it far and wide. If you're on Facebook, all of the Facebook groups, whether the Knitting, Sewing, Taipei, whether the, you know, whist groups, motorbike groups, car groups, I don't care what groups they are. If you're in a group, share the videos, get people to watch. If we only pick up 10% of the people that say the link, it's an extra God knows how many millions. Just do it, people. Do it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Get on people's nerves. Share videos. Keep doing it. Don't say no. There we go. Right. So, I think we'll be back on Thursday, will we not? But probably not for this length of time.
No, no, not for this length of time, no. But on Thursday, there shall be clouds.
There shall.
Stereo.
Oh, yeah, because I went and bought one, didn't I, as well?
Self's been sitting there very quiet.
I'd just like to point out as well, actually, someone did mention in chat when we switched to my studio that it's remarkably less cloudy all of a sudden. That's because I'm now coming in from a different camera. The camera that you saw me on earlier is the Thursday camera, where I like to show off the cloudage. This one's a bit better. There we are.
Yeah. Mm. I'm seeing your cloudage in the background.
Yeah, you, Marco's seeing the camera. Anyway, whatever. Look, we're going to see you on Thursday. Mr. Dawn will be hosting. I believe Keith's with you as well, is he, Dave?
Yeah, he should be, yeah.
Good, 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 good. Should we say goodnight?
I reckon we should.
There.
Yes.
I think we should all join in and say, vape on.
Vape on.
Vape hard.
Vape hard.
And don't let the bastards in ash grind you down.
Yep.
Yeah. Didn't let them.
No. Ta-da, folks. See you on Thursday.